Right here, right now, no exception. Right here, right now, no exception. Right here, right now, no exception. That is the mantra of awakening. That this mantra dawned upon me this morning as I woke up, and I began to apply it, and I began to see, yes, right here, where? Right here, when? Right now. What? No exception. This is the key to awakening. This is the key to feeling not trapped at all. It's the alternative to feeling hopelessly trapped. I tell you this, that we either feel hopelessly trapped or not trapped at all. That is a fact. That really is a fact. And this will soon become evident in the world, that there will be, the world will either feel, oh, we're hopelessly trapped. They'll feel that way, or there will be those who say, we're not trapped at all. Not at all. Not at all. Okay, let me explain this then. It's very, very crucial at this time when events are now really, really going to heat up. They're heating up, and there's some events in the world taking place right now most people don't know about. I happened to be clued into them last night. I asked for a prayer. I said, is there anything I need to pay attention to? And I stumbled across something that was quite shocking, actually. Yes, quite shocking. But it's very, very relevant. I'm very aware of this, and events are heating up. So we have to heat up as well as far as accepting a clarification. We have to heat up our spiritual practice, our inquiry, our sadhana, our discipline, our concentration, our focus, our will, our determination. We need to heat that up too. Because we don't want to feel hopelessly trapped. We want to feel not trapped at all. Not trapped at all. Now, the only issue we have, as I have said repeatedly, is the continuity issue. Is the continuity issue. And the continuity issue is resolved by perceiving a perception in which there's only oneness without any exception. In other words, no exclusion, a total non-exclusionary perception in which everything is equally touched by this beauty, by this presence, equally, without any exception whatsoever. That is the entire key to solving the continuity problem. There is no other way to solve it, because the issue we're dealing with is that we believe reality can be fragmented, that an exception can be made to the will of God, and that is not true. God's will is fixed. There is no exception to it. And so in order to reawaken in reality and realize we never left it, we have to have something first that reminds us, that gets us, eases us into that awakening, which is a vision of oneness, a perception of nothing being excluded from the perception, from the presence of non-threat, as it were, from beauty. And that reminds us of reality. We say, ah, this reminds me of reality. Very clearly reminds me of reality. And then we can realize we never left reality, and God's will is fixed. The entire solution to the continuity problem hinges on this non-excluding vision. Entirely. Now, if there's one exclusion, that means God's will, we're believing God's will is not fixed. And that absolutely does not solve the continuity problem at all. In other words, you'll feel hopelessly trapped. Hopelessly trapped. Hopelessly trapped. If there's even one exclusion, just one, then it doesn't work at all. Because the total workability, effectiveness of it, the entire effectiveness of the vision of oneness is that there are no exclusions. That's it. It's not effective in any other way. That is the beauty of it. That is the peace of it. That is the stillness. That is the wonderfulness of it. Is there's no exclusion. That is it. That is it. It's not that you can see everything as stupendously beautiful and over here in the corner there's this one exception. No. That entirely invalidates it. 100%. 100% invalidates the effectiveness of it. Entirely. So the effectiveness of the vision of oneness is in there is no corner. There is no exclusion anywhere, 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 anywhere. That is the effectiveness of it. And that is Only that is the effectiveness of it. Without that, no effectiveness. You could have the most beautiful, incredible vision imaginable, but if there's one exception to that, it's not included, it's excluded. Zero effectiveness to solve the continuity problem. You will just have a beautiful vision is all, but it will not solve the continuity problem at all. And therefore, you will continue to feel hopelessly trapped. Hopelessly trapped. But if you don't make any exclusion, you're willing to for nothing to be excluded, then you realize that God, you will realize God's will is fixed. See, no exclusion. And God's will is fixed. You know that this vision is permanent. It remains. And it is what, and it's perfectly effective. And then you will feel, I'm not trapped at all. I am not trapped in the future or time at all. Not at all. You will feel this wonderful liberation. Total liberation from all suffering, all time, all problems. You know you're permanently liberated from it. So you will feel you're not trapped at all. Because the continuity problem has, you realize it is resolved. It is resolved. No question about it. So the entire thing hinges on this not excluding anything. And you can tell which way the world is going by easily. By is the world going in that direction of totally not excluding anything at all from the vision of oneness, the vision of beauty, everything being touched equally by this beautiful, tranquil presence? Or is the world going towards saying, somebody has to be excluded. We want to exclude that one. And once we get rid of the one we want to exclude, that will solve the continuity problem, etc. Is the world going in that direction? Of course it is. Of course it is. And that leads to a massive problem. As soon as you start that ball rolling, I'll say, let's kill this one, because they're the worst. And then you still feel hopelessly trapped because it doesn't solve the continuity problem. You will still feel hopelessly trapped. And then you say, whoa, there must be another bad one. Let's tell, oh, there's another one. And let's kill that one. And then still hopelessly trapped. There's another one. And then this snow starts snowballing. It starts snowballing. As soon as you go down that road, full of intense emotionalism, intense desire for vengeance and revenge and emotionalism and desire to exclude that terrible one that's causing us all this feeling of being hopelessly trapped. That snowballs and an avalanche occurs. The overriding message of the world has to be forgiveness. Not as a means in itself, but as a means to an end. Not as an end in itself, but as a means to an end. As a means to accepting this vision of non-exclusiveness. The vision of non-exclusiveness is already there. It's always present. It's already present. It's not that we manufacture it. It's always been there. It's just we accept it. And as long as we want to make an exception, we won't accept it. We won't see it. Won't be able to. Because we'll say, oh, this is fixed. Oh, I don't want that. No, I don't want God's will to be fixed. I want an exception. I can't see. Where's the exception? I can't find it. And then you'll freak out. You say, oh, I don't want this. So it won't come to you unless you're ready for it and ready to not be freaked out by it. But it's there. It's not something we manufacture, not something we assemble, not something we produce, not something that arrives, that it comes about just because of our choosing. No, it's already there. It's always present. Every moment it's already present for us in our mind to be viewed, to be experienced. It's just that we have not yet chosen that option. We're still trying to make an exception, maybe a beautiful exception. That's another way to do it. There's two ways, basic ways. One is this find someone who's really bad and make an exception for them. I'll say, oh, well, surely that's just. That's justice. But who are we being just to? Ourselves? Not at all. Because that's preventing us from realizing the continuity problem has been solved. So that's not justice for us at all. So if it's not justice for us, who is it justice for? That's the question. When you talk about justice, first start with yourself. What is justice for yourself? Because if it's not justice for yourself, well, why bother? right? And what is justice for yourself? Justice is for yourself is to have the continuity problem solved, so you can realize that you never left reality, and you don't need hypotheticals at all of what if you were destroyed, what if you were destroyed, what then? Don't need that. That's justice. That's the only justice there is. Solving the continuity problem is the only justice there is for us, the only justice. So how do you get that justice? By the vision of non-exclusiveness, vision of oneness. It's the only way. So you can't get it by saying, let's exclude that one. That's not justice for yourself. So people who are bent on vengeance are not extending justice to themselves at all, and thus they're not extending justice to anyone else. They're not showing, hey, this is the way. They're not setting any example of justice at all. So what we need in this world is people who show the example of justice, real justice, which is to accept the resolution of the continuity problem. That's what we need, desperately need that. The world needs those who have accepted justice for true justice. But if we, now the other way is to choose someone who's really beautiful. Say, let's make an exception for them. I mean, surely they're so beautiful, they don't need the overlay, right? Look at this beautiful being, this beautiful presence. They're so beautiful, so wonderful, so nice. We don't even need to include them in the vision. No, I mean, surely they don't need to be overlaid. They're already so beautiful. That again is a very clever way to practice exclusion. Very clever way. The ego's very good at that. Takes spiritual great people who have showcased justice to us, the resolution of the continuity problem in the world, and say, oh, look how beautiful they are. Look how wonderful they are. Make an image, make an idol, make an image, worship them. What you're really worshiping is exclusion, which keeps you hopelessly trapped as well. Thinking like, well, surely we can make an exception for them. Surely vision doesn't even need to cover them, which is saying, again, God's will is not fixed. That's a very dangerous trap, the one that I kind of fell into and stumbled pretty badly on that one, because you don't expect it to come from that direction, but it does too. It comes from that direction as well. That's making an idol and saying, look at this beautiful idol. We don't. It's not right to have this one included with all the riffraff and ugliness. Surely you don't mean that in the vision of non-exclusiveness, a vision of oneness, that you're going to include all these murderers and killers and ugly stuff, and they too are touched by the oneness equally. Surely you don't mean that they're equally touched to this beautiful, wonderful idol here. Are you kidding me? That's not just. They say that's not just. So you see how the whole issue of justice is twisted and distorted into saying it's not just that equal oneness should touch this beautiful idol as well as these most hideous criminals, etc. You see? But again, the entire utility, usefulness of the vision of oneness is the non-exclusive nature of it. Nothing's excluded from it. That is no exceptions. That is the entire usefulness of it, is no exceptions. Without that, it's useless for us. Because in reality, there are no exceptions whatsoever. None. Impossible. So how can we overcome the continuity problem that we have except by seeing no exceptions? So to make a beautiful idol and then to claim that it's unjust that this one be included with everything else, especially the riffraff and the horrible stuff, is practicing no justice to yourself whatsoever, because it doesn't solve the continuity problem, leaves the continuity problem entirely unsolved, and you still feel hopelessly trapped. And then you're just stuck with a beautiful idol. And what good is that? It's dead. It's nothing. It doesn't solve the problem. It's useless. So I've been through that part of it. I know that very well. Don't make idols out of anyone. Say this one too is included in a vision of oneness, and this one too, and this. It's super important to train your mind to not make any exceptions in any way for anything. To say this one too isn't it included. Take the greatest gurus ever come on the face of this earth and say this one too is included in the vision of oneness, and then take the worst person, mass murderer or whatever, in the history of the planet, and say this one too is included in the vision of oneness, equally. No difference whatsoever as far as the vision of oneness, because remember that God, for one thing, God pays no attention to dreaming, to hypotheticals, none, absolutely none. Only God only gave the blessing, say the blessing, and the blessing again pays no attention to content whatsoever. It only, because it knows the only problem is continuity, and it's solved by equal blessing, with no judgment whatsoever of content. So the blessing doesn't pay any attention to content. Totally irrelevant. So the highest guru that's ever been here, the most beautiful guru that's ever been here, and the most savage, terrible, wicked, evil monster that's ever been here, is equal blessing in the vision of oneness. Equal blessing. Not excluded. Nothing's excluded. Content is not the issue at all. Content has not never been the issue, never will be the issue. The issue is usefulness and solving the continuity problem. That's the issue. That's justice. So this is an entirely different way of looking at the situation than what the world pushes. So no wonder why you have trouble when you come in. I no wonder why I've had trouble. I tried to bring this into the world, but the world, it was too difficult because I was not quite able to see it clearly enough, but now I am. Now I can see it clearly enough. But it is diametrically opposite of what the world teaches in every possible way. And you tried, you know, I shouldn't be so tough on myself, because if I look around, do I have any allies in the world? No, I can't find any, and not really. There's some trying to, but as far as really pushing it through adamantly, you know, no. So no wonder why it's so difficult. You can't find allies. You start to panic. Really. You keep thinking, well, I've got to have allies, so I have to accept whatever my allies are thinking. I have to accept that. So it's very difficult to promulgate a teaching like this without allies. It's very difficult. So of course it's been difficult for me, really. And of course I tried to find allies, and in this day and age it is very difficult. Because what's happened in this day and age is, with the globalization that technology has brought in, there is a feeling, a global feeling, that we now are going to be able to find the bad guys. They can't hide from us anymore. And we're going to be able to get them. You see? What this has done is it has inflamed the false way so much, and emboldened them, and they feel like, hey, finally we're going to succeed in excluding what we need to exclude so that we can be happy. Because in the past, you know, the desperados would always slip off into the darkness. The cockroaches would always go in and hide somewhere. And now we feel like, hey, cockroaches can't hide anymore. We're going to find them. We got all the spy satellites everywhere, all the globalization, all the social media, and we're going to find the collaborators. We're going to find who's the bad guys, who did what. We're going to get justice, retribution, vengeance. We're going to get it. And so the world's saying, hey, and that has caught the world up in this egoic mentality, which is disastrous, which only leads to a greater feeling of being hopelessly trapped, which leads to a greater feeling of vengeance. It's a spiral. It's a downward spiral that is like a free fall. It is really like a free fall. And if you're alarmed, you should be about that. But not to the point of panic, because I'm telling you that I do have the perception as far as the perspective on this. Not the perception, yet the perspective on it that leads to the perception. And I must have some allies at some level, maybe subtle level, I don't know. And there must be some, I don't know. But even if there aren't any, I still have it. So I'm not going to throw it away even if there is nobody here. I don't know. It's easy to see for me right at this point. So the problem again, to restate the problem, and we have to be aware, there is a severe problem in the world right now. It's the most severe problem this world's ever faced, by far, is the ego's plan of salvation, which is to exclude those who should be excluded, which doesn't solve the continuity problem at all, doesn't touch upon it at all, it makes it worse. And the continuity problem is the only problem we have. That's it. There is no other problem we have, because we never left reality. We're still in reality. We just have to realize that. And we won't realize it until we have a dream which reminds us of reality. And only the dream of no exclusion, dream of oneness, reminds us of reality. Make one exception and it doesn't remind us of reality at all. Not at all. Okay, so that's the only problem we have. So the ego's way of exclusion only makes things worse. And the problem is the globalization that technology has brought on this planet. We have 7 billion people on this planet, and almost all of them are infected with this virus of saying, hey, you know, if somebody does something wrong that I don't like or whatever, we can get them. We can find where they are, who they are, where they are. We can track them. We can bring them to justice now. They can't slip away into the hinterlands anymore. Right? We got them. And there's this overwhelming sort of cohesiveness among the planet, especially among the young people who grew up with technology and fully realize the how to use it. You see, my generation, you know, it's like, yeah, I know how it's used, but I'm not obsessed by it. And I say, hey, it's not necessary. As far as salvation goes, there's no need for it whatsoever. None. I can find right use for it, like these videos, sure. That's just being intelligent, right use of time. But as far as, hey, we can use it to track everybody. No, not like that. I don't want to track anyone. I don't have any desire to track anybody. None, no desire. I don't have any desire to find out what somebody else is doing, to judge anybody, to track them, collect data on that. No desire for that whatsoever, because it's totally useless. Totally pointless. Completely useless. For the purpose of salvation, the vision's already here. Vision of oneness is already here. No exclusion. That's all we need. We don't need to track anybody to bring them to justice. Justice is accepting the vision of oneness. That is justice. So, even though I'm aware of technology and I'm utilizing it, it's not for the same reason that the other people, especially the younger generations who've grown up with it. I didn't grow up with technology at all. No. I grew up with a dial phone, okay, and a slide rule. And I never even used calculators in high school. Never used them. Still don't use them. I just do it in my head or do it on a piece of paper for the most part. Occasionally, I finally use one a little bit, but I almost never even use a calculator. A phone is just to make calls, just the same as we used to make. Just if you want to call someone, you call them. So there's no desire for me to get into people's heads, get into their lives, get into what they like or don't like, get into any of that. No desire at all. I don't care. For me, just live and let live. Live and let live. It doesn't matter what you do. It doesn't matter who you are. None of that matters. None of it matters at all. What matters is simply you accepting the vision of oneness. That resolves the continuity problem. That's it. But the world sees things very differently than that. And they see that they have all these tools at their disposal. Finally, they say, finally, we can track down who needs to be excluded. And we can find out once and for all, and then we can do it. We can exclude them. And they think then the golden age will arrive. Well, how utterly and totally drastically wrong they are about that. What arrives is an even deeper sense of being hopelessly trapped. And after you know, the killing can only go so far until you just collapse, everything just collapses, and you just say, oh my gosh. And then the depression and despair sets in. And you just think, we tried to exclude everyone we possibly could exclude, and we failed, and now what? And, oh boy, and then it's just, you know, it goes on and on. And that, so again, the world faces the most severe situation it's ever faced because of the globalization of technology is fueling the desire for vengeance, revenge, attack, exclusion. They say we can find you. You can't hide. You cannot hide. You go in some cave, you cannot hide. Which is why they don't want anyone to relocate off this planet, okay? Keep this in mind, that the whole point of this world, the agenda of this world is to track down those that they want to exclude. And then come to a consensus. Okay, who do we want to exclude? Well, they already got Gaddafi. They already got Saddam. You know, they're getting these icons that they want to exclude. They say, okay, let's just get rid of Saddam. Everything's fine. Let's just get rid of Bin Laden. Everything's fine. Let's just get rid of Gaddafi. Okay, everything's fine. So, wait a minute. Okay, that's not quite final. Let's get rid of this war criminal. Okay, we'll get rid of them. Okay, and gradually it starts building up. Like I say, hey, you know, we can get rid of anybody we want to get rid of. And it hasn't worked yet, so there must be someone else really bad somewhere. Let's get rid of them. And the collective will of the planet starts to get hitched to this wagon, you see. And with the social media and everything, and the flash mobs, mobs can be mobilized now. Really. What mobility really means, M-O-B-I-L-I-T-Y, mob ability. Okay, mobility is really mob ability. And of course, in Obama, M-O-B, mob, is there also. Mob ability. Think about that. That's really what we're coming to, is mob ability. Is the ability to assemble mobs, lynch mobs, all over the planet. And that is what it will come to. And what will happen probably is the world will get into such a situation where the world will decide, oh my gosh, we're going headed towards anarchy, mob rule, and then they'll desperately look for an idol to impose dictatorship over the planet. And then that dictatorship will then be used to systematically and bureaucratically eliminate, exclude those we want to exclude, you see. And so it'll be this global totalitarian dictatorship ruthlessly culling out those that it feels need to be excluded in order for the golden age in order to take place. So you have all this coming up. It's completely obvious what's going on, really. Now, exactly how it plays out, we don't know, but the intent and the dynamics are all present, entirely present. And, you know, people are just tracking people on, they all have these smartphones, which are really mob devices to track people, to hunt people down. They're really like, you talk about guns being dangerous, smartphones are way more dangerous because those enable mobs, lynch mobs, to track people down and assemble the lynch mobs with boom, like that. That's even more, talk about dangerous, that's even more dangerous. And the reason why people want to keep their guns is they don't want to be subjected to these lynch mobs. And it's a global thing, it's a global thing. So mob ability, the ability to exclude someone, the ability to bully and exclude someone. Is where we're at. We're already at, you know, there. I see all the people with smartphones, the ones that have them. It's amazing. They're like this, you know, like this. Just, and they're wired, they're hardwiring, they're soft wiring, as it were, wirelessly wiring themselves into this global network of activism. Okay, global network of activism. What is activism all about? Activism is all about getting rid of the bad stuff. That's what it's about, getting rid of the bad stuff. Okay, what does that have to do with the vision of Christ and salvation? It has nothing to do with it. The vision of Christ says completely ignores all content. Totally ignores all content of dreams and just extends a universal blessing equally upon all dreams, good, the bad, and the ugly. And that reminds us of reality, and that solves the continuity problem, and bingo, we realize we never left reality, and reality is, of course, heaven, you know, total paradise. And we realize we're there, we've always been there. That's justice for us. Nothing else is justice for us. Nothing else is justice for what we are, you see. As we seek all this other stuff, vengeance and activism to exclude, to get rid of the bad stuff, we're saying we don't know who we are. We don't know who we are at all. Who are we pursuing justice for is a question. Who are we? We're spirit. We're divinity. We're the children of God, the prime creator, children of reality, with full membership in reality. So what is justice for us is to realize this, to realize we never left there. Right now, we're hypothetically imagining that we did leave, you see, that we could leave at some point. We're hypothetically saying, what if we did leave? And we're imagining, we're dreaming, what if we left? And these are very terrible dreams, dreams of disaster, dreams of nightmares, nightmare of disaster. And that long nightmare can be over right now, with right here, right now, no exclusion. Right here, right now, no exception. No exception. So, what I'm doing is I'm delineating the two paths, the sheep and the goats, okay? There really is a delineation here, and you need to see that. The goats are the activists. The sheep are the non-activists. The sheep are the forgivers. Okay, they say, hey, I know that excluding something, I'm excluding myself from the remedy to the continuity problem. Absolutely. And so I will still feel hopelessly trapped. So I have to see it that way and accept that the vision of oneness. No exception. I have to go that way. So the sheep are the ones who are saying, okay, I'm going towards no exception, which is what I've been working on my whole life. And the goats are the ones who are saying, no. The activists are saying, no, we need to get rid of the bad stuff. Total opposite directions, right? Wheat from the chaff. That's what Jesus said. The wheat from the chaff will be separated. The sheep from the goats will be separated out. That's what they're talking about. Different destiny paths. See, it's all coming together right now. All becoming very clear. Relocation, non-relocation. Hopelessly trapped, not hopelessly trapped. You see, the relocation, the activists don't want that because they say, hey, you might be the bad stuff. And if you're the bad stuff, we have to destroy you in order for us to be saved. So it's not fair to us. It's not justice to us. Well, when they say that, they're not talking about what they really are. They're talking about a hypothetical nothingness, really. And so how can you give justice to nothing? That's ridiculous. So they don't know what justice is. Jesus says, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they're doing. In other words, they don't know who they are, and so therefore they don't know what justice is. How can you be justice? How can you give justice to yourself if you don't know who you are, what you are, and you think you're something else that you're not? You're trying to give justice to something else that you're not, which isn't justice to what you are. So the activists think they got to close the borders, you know, shut the world down, lock down, put an iron curtain around the whole world, and nobody can escape. You should realize this. And what happened in the Soviet Union when the activists took over? They went about their work, bureaucratic work, of saying, okay, let's get rid of the bad stuff. Okay, well, who were the bad stuff in that time? Well, they were the middle class, bourgeois landholders, the business people who knew what they were doing. And of course, because they knew what they were doing, and business-wise, they accumulated the land, and they were fairly well off. And the peasants, of course, were not. And so when the activists took over, they said, okay, let's get rid of who are the bad guys? They said, okay, these are the bad guys. And they sent them all to the gulag. Had them build a road of bones out in Siberia. Stuck them in concentration camps in Siberia. That's the gulag. That's exactly what they did. And also what they did is they shut the borders. They shut the borders. Eastern, you know, the Berlin Wall, Eastern Europe. You could not escape. They had borders, walls, borders, security, barbed wire, checkpoints. You couldn't leave. That's very important to the activists. You can't leave, you see, because they say, who wants to leave? They say, it must be the people who feel like threatened by us. And who would be feeling threatened by us? The activists say, the bad stuff, the stuff we want to get rid of. They must be the ones who want to leave. So we can't let them leave. So we have to be able to track them down. And if we keep them within our borders, then we can track them down, and then we can send them to the gulag, or we can just summarily execute them. Send them through a kangaroo court, but that, we worry about that. So, of course, the first thing the activists do is they want to shut the borders down, prevent anyone from leaving. Because then how... If they didn't do that, they figure all the bad stuff is going to scurry away. The cockroaches are going to go hide somewhere. We can't find them. So we got to shut everything down. So right now, global global activism, its purpose is to shut down the borders of this planet, which there are certain ways to do that. And they don't want anybody leaving the planet, actually, now. That's actually the issue. The issue isn't leaving the Iron Curtain of Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union, getting to the West. That's no longer the issue. The issue is leaving the planet. That is the issue. And the activists don't want anyone to leave the planet, because they have this technology now to hunt you down anywhere on the planet. You can't hide out on some island somewhere in the South Pacific. They got all those islands mapped. They have satellite technology on all those islands. They know every reef. They know every bit of topography. They have all these gadgets now. It's amazing, all these different gadgets they have that can sense stuff remotely and sense all these things. So I was going through a tool catalog recently, and that all these gadgets that are sensing subtle stuff, gas, infrared, heat, you name it, they have a gadget to sense it now. Moisture. So all this stuff is designed to track down the bad stuff. And people's consciousness has been caught up in this. They may not even be aware of it, but they're really locked into this notion of tracking down the bad stuff, whether the bad stuff is CO2, carbon dioxide, whether it is moisture, mold, heat loss, infrared heat loss, energy loss, hazardous waste, you name it. The consciousness of this planet is locked into the activism of tracking down the bad stuff. This very easily gets transferred onto people, very easily. And we don't realize that how locked in the planet is to this right now. And it gets very easily translated into, let's shut down the planet. Let's lock down, put the planet in lockdown mode. Put the planet in total lockdown mode so nobody escapes, because we want the opportunity to find out who's the bad stuff, where's the bad stuff, and then get rid of it. And then we think a golden age will ensue. Nothing could be more delusional or further from the truth. It has absolutely nothing to do with salvation. It has nothing to do with justice. Absolutely zero. Zero. Complete waste of time. So those institutions that stand for tolerance and forgiveness are the global treasures, actually. Global treasures that have stood in the way of locking down the planet, have stood in the way of activism, have stood in the way of getting rid of the bad stuff. And they have been sabotaged and undermined and attempt to collapse these institutions, however feeble they may be. I mean, religion has been feeble in the world, or whatever institutions that stood for forgiveness. Not all religions necessarily stand for forgiveness, but there is that element in them to some extent. It's a mixed bag, but still, it's better than nothing. It's better than this activism, which is now, the globe is seized by this activism. That's crumbling, with the Pope stepping down and the power vacuum there and the instability and all of that. It emboldens the activists, extremely emboldens them. They're emboldened right now with the re-election of Obama. They're extremely emboldened, and it's all going to take place now, because the president won't stand in their way. He won't stand in their way. Will not. It's kind of complicity by not doing anything about it. By not saying no, we must go in the direction of forgiveness. No, if the world leaders are not standing up and saying we will go in the direction of forgiveness and salvation, we must do that as a planet. If they're not doing it, then the activists, it's their day, the day of the jackal, for sure. They say that, you know, there's complicity by not saying anything about it. If there's a crime and no one says anything about it, that's complicity. Like Joe Paterno was complicit in his, that scandal, because supposedly he didn't really do enough to stop it, you see. So that's complicity. By not speaking up, you're complicit. Jesus says, if you know and you don't speak up, then he says, I don't know you, as it were. Just like saying you're complicit. So the thing about the leaders of the world is that they are weak, and they're not willing to stand up and say what needs to be said. And therefore, they allow the activism to take place and to be emboldened and to say, hey, full speed ahead with all this getting rid of the bad stuff. So you really can't say someone like that is a leader at all. Not a leader at all. It's just complicit in this activism, and just kind of what they do is, hey, don't worry, everybody. I got it under control. I'm cool. I'm hip. I'm sophisticated. I'm smart, and I got it all under control. Don't worry. Not a problem. I know how to deal with all this. And it just kind of that kind of enabling. Really, it's enabling by just saying, hey, don't worry. This is all great. It's not a problem. Any problems, I'll deal with it. I've got my hands in everything. I know exactly how to handle it. No, they're just enabling it. Enablers. So leaders of the world now are just enablers, really. And whatever all the complaints about, for instance, the church, the Roman Catholic Church, which I certainly have complaints about the theology and what they're teaching. It's not accurate, really, but they certainly try to stand for forgiveness and loving kindness, and other teachings and religions also do that. They try. At least some effort is there. Some effort is there. Forgiveness is there. And turn the other cheek. They try to teach that. You know, they struggle. Struggle, but they try. And so that provides some help to deflect the activism, spirit of activism in the world. But the church has been infected with social justice movement, all this activist movement. So that's the schism in the church, is between those who, the sheep who want to go towards forgiveness and salvation, and the goats who want to go to social activism, to activism. That's the schism. There's a terrible schism in the church right now. In fact, the last time a pope stepped down, I think it was Gregory something, 600 years ago, was the great schism in the 14th century. There was a great schism at that time. And I guess his stepping down was supposed to heal the schism in the church. Well, right now, Benedict talks about a great schism in the church. He's saying the church is torn. The church is torn. There's this internal division within the church that people are trying to follow their own agenda as well. The schism in the church is between forgiveness and activism. It's that simple. It's that simple. There's a lot of young people in the church, a lot of the youth in the church and the young leaders of the church and the younger element in the church are much more driven by activism. And the older ones are much more driven towards forgiveness. Forgiveness. Let us all pray and follow Jesus' example of, Father, forgive them, for they know what they do. Jesus showed us that even being crucified, he's still nothing but forgiveness. Nothing but forgiveness. Teaching non-exclusion. Don't go after the bad guys. He never went after the bad guys, did he? He never did he? And Peter picked up his sword in the Garden of Gethsemane and wanted to cut off the centurion's ear and wanted to attack it. Jesus said, no, set your sword down. No. That's not the way. That's not what I came here for, to teach you. And when Barabbas came to him and said, hey, we need to, the zealots, we need to revolt against Rome. And we must stir up activism in the land. And Jesus says, no. Peace, forgiveness, love your enemies. Render unto Caesar what is Caesar's. And Barabbas was outraged. The zealots were outraged. And they went to the Sadducees and said, hey, you need to bring up charges against this guy because he's teaching pacifism among the land, and we want, you know, rebellion. And the Sadducees were worried enough about the zealots that they decided, okay, let's bring up charges against him, just from a political expedient standpoint. It was really the zealots that crucified Jesus. The Sadducees were the political, had the political power in that time, and they were meticulous about following the law. And then the zealots said, "Hey, Jesus, he disobeyed the law. He healed on the Sabbath and all this stuff." And the Sadducees says, "Well, we can't have that. We need the people to follow the law." And the zealots said, "Well, hey, you need to let's get rid of this guy. He's bad stuff. And if you don't get rid of him, we're going to stir up trouble." And so the Sadducees said, okay, we'll bring the case to Pilate and get him crucified. That's basically what happened. So Jesus didn't go along with the activism. He said, that's not the way. That's the opposite of the way. So you have the same situation in the world now. The zealots, the activists, are the ones that are driving the situation in the world. And the Sadducees are like the world leaders who are kind of feel threatened by the zealots and say, hey, we want to keep our power and our glory of being leaders of the world. We need to play ball with the zealots. And the zealots say, okay, we need to get rid of this bad stuff. And the leaders say, okay. Same situation. And you have those like Pilate who are willing to say, well, okay, I'm not going to stand in the way. Same thing. History repeating itself right now. And of course, the zealots eventually did try to drive out Rome. And Titus came down from Rome with the Roman legions and absolutely annihilated the area. Didn't leave a single stone standing, tore down the whole wall around Jerusalem, tore down the second temple, slaughtered over 1 million people, cut down all the trees, all the shrubbery. They're beautiful suburbs in Jerusalem at that time, and there was a desert. They turned all of Jerusalem into a desert. There was no more water wells, there was no more trees, houses, everything was razed, and all the people either killed or put into slavery, or just they fled and dispersed all over the planet. And then people came to Jerusalem, they're looking for it. They said they couldn't even find it. They couldn't even recognize it. They said, where are we? I don't even know where we are. Just a desert here, just desolation. That's what happened. That's what the zealots brought upon Jerusalem. Jesus wouldn't have brought that upon Jerusalem. Not at all. So look out for the zealots, because as they go after the bad stuff, is what they think is the bad stuff. Bad stuff happens, that is for sure. The spirit of destruction marches in unexpected ways, and unexpected consequences take place. But never before in the history of the planet has the spirit of activism been as strong as it is now. Never before, anything like this, really. And what I'm seeing is the mobs are in charge, and politicians are trembling. Look at Bangladesh, the Shahbag movement right now. The politicians are just crumbling. It's amazing. You get a mob, and they're shouting for justice, and the politicians say, oh my God, we got to change the law retroactively. Let's make all verdicts appealable, both prosecution and defense. So they're changing laws retroactively because they're terrified of the mob. Terrified. The politicians are running scared from the zealots. The activists, they absolutely are. That's stunning. You know, the Shahbag movement is stunning to show you the rapidity of what can happen right now, where the mobs literally are enforcing laws, are writing their own laws and rules, saying this is what we want. If you don't, we're going to have the whole country's going to be plunged into chaos. We're going to shut everything down. And the leaders say, oh my gosh, we got to save our own skins. Okay, let's change the laws. Okay, you get people in power right now who are afraid, who are so egotistical and narcissistic that they want desperately to be leaders at any cost, at any price. And the mob will come to them and say, hey, listen, if you don't change the laws, we are going to depose you. Then the leader will say, okay, we'll change the laws, but what do you want? Okay, what do you want? You want martial law? You got it. You want the internet shut down? You got it. You want all this stuff happen? No problem. I'll make an executive order. Whatever executive order you want, done deal. Just don't bother me. Just don't depose me. I like being the big chief kind of thing. In other words, so that is the situation we have. We have very weak leaders on the planet right now. I mean, it's unbelievable. It's unbelievable what we have right now. We have those who simply are there because they like the perks and the ego trip that it is, and they're willing to sell everybody out just to keep their position, and they'll sell everybody out to the mob. They'll sell Christ out to the mob. They'll turn Christ over to the mob and say, well, you know, do whatever you want to do. It doesn't, as long as you don't bother me, that's okay. As long as I keep my position, that's okay. And they're willing to change any law right now. Any law. Like that. How can you have a trial of somebody and a verdict and then after the verdict takes place, say, well, hey, you know what? Let's go back and change the law. And let's say that all verdicts are appealable by both sides, whereas before, no, it was only the defense that could appeal a verdict by the prosecution. Now they say, no, let the prosecution can now appeal a verdict also, retroactively like that. See, that should get everyone's attention. The Shabbat movement should get everybody's attention right now, actually. The whole world should be looking at this and saying, uh-oh. Because this is a precursor to what's going to happen in the world, okay? It's a precursor where the rulers, the lawmakers, are going to make retroactive laws. Retroactive laws. Imagine that. Which is exactly what the activists are pushing for, which I've been telling you that in certain videos. Is what I'm saying is you're going to be accused of stuff retroactively, which was not stuff was not a crime in the past. You will now be criminalized. And they will say, oh, that now we're saying that the non-criminality of what you did in the past can now be appealed as a criminal action, can now be prosecuted as a criminal action. For instance, like the Boy Scouts can now be, you know, sued and prosecuted for their excluding gays in the past. Retroactively, the laws will be said, okay, you committed very bad crimes, and you can be sued for massive amounts of money. The church will be sued. The same thing, didn't allow gay marriage, that you committed a severe crime against humanity. So all this stuff will be turned into crimes against humanity. And these laws will be retroactive to anything anyone's done in the past. You'll now be seen as part of the bad stuff that the activists need to get rid of. So you need to be aware of what's going on in the world. You need to be aware of what salvation really is, which I can tell you and perhaps showcase for you at some point soon. And also understand the lockdown of this world and the retroactive laws which will be written into law. Shabak movement right now in Bangladesh, Dhaka, and the rulers of Dhaka, in order to save their own skins, have suddenly pushed through, almost by decree, rubber stamped it, retroactive law, changing the law retroactively to now change the game on a defendant. Amazing. Amazing, right? And when people say, well, he's a really terrible guy. Yeah, absolutely. But that's not the point. The point is setting this precedent of the power of activism. You see, that is the whole point of the situation that's going on, is activists now seeing that they can cause politicians to retroactively change laws that have retroactive reach to them. This is the incredible danger that the world is in right now. Incredible danger. Just think. Just think about it and how it can be applied and how it is going to be applied. Anybody now can be sued retroactively for anything that they did in the past, even though something was common practice in the past and it was accepted in the past. That now we say, you know what, we don't like the way that is. And those people back then, 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, didn't do it the way we want like it now, so we should be able to sue them, imprison them, criminalize them for what they did in the past. For instance, the church excluding gays or gay marriage, exclusion of all states, all whatever, they say, you know what, that's a great crime against humanity, violation of civil rights, violation of humanity, crime against humanity, and now you need to pay the price, and we need to obliterate you. The price that you need to pay is the disbanding. The activists actually want the church to be disbanded, all religions to be disbanded, to be obliterated. That is actually a fact. And they want laws to be written which will give the leverage of lawsuits and criminalization to obliterate it. companies too. Companies, they want to take over all the companies and corporations of the world by retroactive laws, which say that you discriminated, you excluded, you discriminated 50 years ago, you didn't allow women to be CEOs or whatever. You know, the whole feminist thing is aimed at education and corporations and all this, these major institutions, to actually take them over and then make them instruments of vengeance and justice and retribution, getting rid of the bad stuff. Because the global totalitarianism will be based on a set of laws, retroactive laws, actually. Who polluted, you know, who polluted the air, who did this, who did this. The environmental movement will pass retroactive laws of saying you did this long ago, and now you must be held accountable for what you did back then, when what you did back then was legal. Was legal. Like, for instance, what if you drove like a car? We all drove cars that didn't have catalytic converters, right? And they could say, hey, everybody who drove a car back in the 60s and 70s and polluted the air and gave rise to this global warming are now guilty of great crimes. You see how the younger generation can charge the older generation with great crimes, right? I just say, hey, look at the carbon footprint that you did back then. Look at all the trees you chopped down for paper. You see, all this paper products, they chopped all the trees. They say, we're wireless. We don't use those paper products. You're guilty of poisoning the planet. And so you need to be sent to concentration camps because of this. Retroactive laws, like in the Soviet Union, the middle class weren't breaking any laws. They were functioning exactly as the law allowed them to function, in a very sane way. And then the Soviets took over, socialist communists took over, and they said retroactively, they said, hey, you guys were breaking the law like crazy, because they rewrote the laws and says now you're in violation of these laws, and these laws should have been in place, and we're now putting them in place retroactively. So you have a younger generation that can criminalize the older generation entirely. You drove a muscle car, oh my God. You drove any car, polluted the heck out of the atmosphere, didn't it? Lead, high octane, you know, you had high octane. So you can be criminalized in every possible way. Every possible way. Through your attitudes, through the environmental thing. That's a big one. Global warming will use to institute like international tribunals, as it were, global tribunals. When the mob gets control, the activists control the younger generation, they view the older generation as criminals, severe criminals, and they see the golden age as getting rid of the bad stuff of the activists. Of course, got to get rid of the bad stuff. So who contributed to global warming so badly? Who chopped down the trees? You know, all this kind of stuff. And say, okay, they need to pay the price for that. The planet insists upon it. The mother Earth, Mother Gaia, insists upon that, upon justice. Mother Gaia insists upon justice. The bad stuff must be plowed under like they never existed. And let's move on to a golden age. Let's put the past behind us. We need closure. Before we can go forward, we need closure. That's another thing the activists talk about. Before we go forward, we must have closure. We must have the bad stuff pulverized into dust so it can never arise again. You see? So, global activism under the banner of Mother Earth, Mother Gaia, the goddess. The goddess demands justice. All right, you should see it everywhere. You should be awakening to this and realize, wow, this isn't the path that Jesus pointed out to us. This isn't the path of salvation at all. It's the path of extreme damnation, the path of extreme helplessness, hopelessness, feeling totally trapped, helplessly and hopelessly trapped. It's that path. I know I've been on that path to the bitter end. I saw what the end is. That is total mental chaos, which is hideous beyond any description you can possibly use. You cannot use a description for it. It's so terrible. I tasted that. I've tasted it, which is why I'm so adamant about trying to sharing this information with everyone, the activists, along with everyone else in this world, sharing it and saying, hey, you're going down a path that's leading you to that mental chaos. And you don't want to taste that. If you taste it, spit it out. It's so terrible you can't swallow it. And then at that point, you realize, uh-oh, this isn't going to work. Activism doesn't work. Getting rid of the bad stuff doesn't work, because this is what I end up with, which is the worst stuff imaginable. So then you have to, then you'll thank God that there are those who realize this and showcase what salvation is really about. Then you'll say, oh my God, thank God. Thank God there are these great gurus and great saviors, the saviors who know the way, because then they'll show you the way and you'll get clued in, and then you'll be very grateful for that. Whereas right now, most people, they have no use for those. No use. To show you how bad it is, to show you how bad it is right now, the very area in Shahbagh, which is being used to launch this activist revolution, really, of retroactive laws, is the very place that Ananda Mayi, the unsurpassed showcase of salvation on this planet, where she lived, very place where she spent all her years, many years in Dhaka, in that Shahbagh area. That's where she lived, her house was. That's where she spent a lot of time. That's where the ashram was built. That very place is now being used for the exact opposite. The activists have no awareness of this fact whatsoever. None. Zero. Zero. They could care less. Absolutely care less. It's just incredible to me. That place should be one of the holiest places on the planet. That place should be a world sanctuary. That Shahbagh area should be a world sanctuary, because that is where Sri Ananda Mayi had her coming out to the world and showed, hey, I am here. The perfect showcase of salvation is here, showcasing equal vision. She showcased equal vision perfectly to the planet. She said, everything I see is equally blessed. Everything. Everything. Without any exception, she showcased it perfectly, the planet. And that's the place where her coming out to the planet took place, in the Shahbagh, the very place where the activists are threatening the politicians and causing them to institute retroactive laws. That is the very place, the very ground that she walked on and sat on and radiated this bliss and love to the entire planet. That's the very place where it's taking place, the very ground. The very soil that she walked on is now being walked on, trampled on by this activist movement. That should get your attention. That should be a shock. You should realize the ferocity and intensity of this movement. Nothing else could say it any better. Nothing else could possibly say it any better. And of course, the ground that Jesus walked upon, also in Jerusalem and the Near East, that area. The West Bank, we walked on the West Bank, he walked in the areas now Israel. I mean, he walked in all these areas. The soil he walked has been the hotbed of activism for quite some time now. But the new activism, the global activism of the technology and the flash mobs, all this, which is the what is really going to cause the problem, that's all now, right now, is centered on the very soil that Sri Ananda Mayi Ma was walking on and touching and being right there. It's like, oh my gosh. That should be an eye-opener and should let you know the difference between the sheep and the goats is incredible difference. Literally. The gulf is so vast. I mean, I actually tried to make that area. I was working on was in the past was foreknowledge. I had foreknowledge of what's going to happen, and I wanted to try to find a way to make that Shahbagh area a global sanctuary, a global spiritual sanctuary. And it didn't happen. And now look what's happening there. In other words, that place would be an area where everyone from all the world would go and pray for the vision of oneness, for forgiveness, for loving kindness, for forgiveness, realizing that the vision of oneness is available to us, it's been showcased to us perfectly, and that it's equal love to everything, no exception, everything that's touched, no exclusion, no exception at all. Total mercy, total compassion, total love. total forgiveness, total oneness. That would be a global center, a global sanctuary for people all over the world to come and abide and radiate this way of the true way of salvation, true justice, a center of true justice in the world. And now it's been turned into a center of true non-justice, injustice. To who? To us. To ourselves. Activism is injustice to ourselves. It's injustice marching under the banner of justice is what it is. And so I actually spent almost a decade trying to bring this about, desperately trying to create an awareness in the world of the importance of making that area, Shahbagh area, a center of true justice. Because that's what Ananda Mai Ma stood for, is true justice. She was a perfect example of true justice, perfect example, flawless example, and was saying, she says, please make room in your heart for me, meaning true justice. Not her personality, but for true justice, which is true justice is to solve the continuity problem. And the way it's solved is the vision of oneness. That is true justice. So when she said, please make room in your heart for this little child, she's saying, make room in your heart for true justice. So it's been really rough to fail in what I tried to do. Because I knew that if I don't do this, look what's going to happen. Well, it's happening. And it wasn't meant to be. It wasn't meant to be. It wasn't meant to establish a sanctuary on this planet. If you can't establish a sanctuary at the Shahbagh area, you can't establish it anywhere. Because that is truly holy ground, as is Jerusalem. And look, we haven't been able to establish a sanctuary in Jerusalem or Galilee or Bethlehem or the West Bank or any of that place. It's absolutely torn with strife. It seems like the areas where holiness comes into the world is turned into the opposite. It's turned into the places of which is the center of injustice. Where justice comes in the world, the ego turns into centers of injustice. So, it was not possible to establish sanctuary, justice here, a center of justice here in this world. And so that's why we need to relocate. Because the activists are saying, look, they're basically saying, look, we're in control. Even here in this most holy ground of Shahbagh, we're in control. So be it. As Jesus said, I'm leaving to go prepare a place for you. So at the end times, I will come back and take you to the place I prepare for you, so you can be with me. What does that mean? So that you can extend justice to yourself. That's what it means. Because this world, they said, why are you leaving this world? And he said, it's a place of total injustice, meaning place of darkness. The prince of darkness is control of it. It means the attitude of injustice, activism, injustice. Is in control of this planet. This planet is a planet of darkness. He said, it's not my kingdom. It's not my Father's kingdom at all. He said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. So I'll take you there at the end of times, which we're now right there. So you can have the opportunity to extend justice to yourself. And so, that is what we have to look forward to, is the opportunity to extend justice for ourselves, to ourselves. And this whole thing is now heating up. And I was shown this Shahbagh movement. I had no idea. I don't pay attention to the news anymore. But somehow, I found it on Facebook. I happened to be a message out, check someone's Facebook page, and was on there. They signed this petition. I said, what is this petition? I checked in, I started looking into it, and then I came across the Shahbagh movement. It just happened. It's only been going like 7 days or something. Just 7 days, and suddenly, in 7 days, the activists have been able to get the leaders of the country to retroactively change laws, change the most fundamental law possible, which is in a trial, is once a verdict is rendered, that the defense has an opportunity to appeal it, but the prosecution doesn't have the opportunity to appeal it. If this is what the sentence is, then that's the sentence. But now they say no. If the prosecution doesn't like the sentence, they say, well, we don't like the sentence. We're going to appeal it. And we're going to change all these other laws to make it possible to do this and this and this and that. And that is more than an eye-opener. So I've come across this, and I said, well, are you kidding me? This very area is the very area that I'm so well acquainted with in the life of Ananda Maima. And this is the very center of it. Wow. That's an eye-opener. That should show the world how far along we are now. No shame, no shame, no shame. Activists have no shame as they pursue injustice. Good God. I mean, can we not at least set aside some area in the world that is free from this, where this area is dedicated to loving forgiveness? Of not judging anyone, judging that everybody is equally blessed by God? Can we not set aside one area? Not even the area that would be most applicable for it? You know? No. Activists say, no, we don't. We could care less about that. We're pursuing injustice. And of course, the whole problem in the world between the sheep and the goats is that the goats don't understand what justice is. They think that getting rid of the bad stuff is justice. So they don't understand that it's injustice. Say, so I need to recount this again for those of you who kind of like shaking like on the fence, like, whoa, things are getting pretty intense right now, aren't they? Yes, they are. The sheep are the ones, the difference between the sheep and the goats, the sheep are the ones that realize that the continuity problem is the only problem we have. We never left reality. We're still in reality. Reality is one, and we're afraid to abruptly wake up and realize we never left. So that's called the continuity problem. It's the only problem we have. And the only way we solve this continuity problem is by being reminded of reality. In other words, dreaming a dream that reminds us of reality. It's the only way. And reality is one without any exception, one without any exclusion. That is reality. So the only way to be reminded of reality is to dream a dream that is not excluding anything or anyone. Nothing is being excluded. Everything is being equally blessed. Reality equally blesses it, all of itself, without exclusion. So we need a dream that equally blesses the dream without any exclusion. A dream blessing itself without any exclusion. That's the only way to solve the continuity problem. So therefore, that's the only thing that's useful to us. That's the only thing we need. We don't need to judge content at all. We don't need to judge. We only need to not exclude. That's why forgiveness is so important. Not exclude. We only need to see a vision that doesn't exclude anything. That solves the continuity problem for us. Those are the sheep. Those are the sheep. Okay, which is very different than the activists. The activists feel that the problem is that bad stuff keeps happening in the world, and they need to find out who's doing the bad stuff and exclude them. So the goats believe that right exclusion solves the problem of happiness, that they'll be happy forever aftermore. In other words, happy in the dream. They're trying to make the dream their home. They say, no, we are a body. We reside in this world. This world is our reality. This body is our identity. And we need to find out what is making us unhappy in this identity as a body in this world, what is causing the problems here, and get rid of the bad stuff, and then we'll have this beautiful world, beautiful bodies, we'll be so happy here, and we'll dwell here forever after. In other words, trying to make the dream real. Trying to make dreams the new reality. Those are the goats. So, of course, they feel justice is to get rid of the bad stuff. Whereas the sheep say justice is to solve the continuity problem. So, there's nothing in between, you know. There's two different paths, divergent paths, entirely divergent paths. There's no way to hold these paths together in some third path. No, they're completely divergent. One says that we need to make exceptions. The other says we must make no exceptions. How can you blend those two? How can you blend one that says the only way is no exceptions, no exclusion? The other says the way, no, there must be an exclusion. How can you blend those? You cannot blend them. You cannot blend them. So many people have tried to say, well, if we just blend the two divergent paths, we can come up with some compromise. There is no such compromise. There is none. So that is a problem with so many in this world who are kind of saying like, hey, we feel that there's a big problem coming up in the world. And how do we avoid it? Well, let's blend the two divergent paths. Let's blend them. Remember, the problem is not coming from the sheep at all. It's only coming from the activists. So to say, well, hey, you're both equally mistaken, let's blend them, is not true. Is not true at all. Or you're equally dangerous and threatening. Not true at all. No, the sheep are not threatening or dangerous in any way. It's solely the activists that are dangerous. Their pursuit of justice will bring death down upon everyone. Just like the zealots, Barabbas and the zealots, they brought down the wrath of Rome, Titus, upon everybody. Women, and children. Indiscriminate, right? Brought destruction down on everything and everyone there. Not the sheep. Jesus didn't bring that destruction down. Not the sheep. No, the sheep only bring blessing upon everything, everyone. Equal blessing, equal love, total blessing, total bliss, total love upon everything, knowing that that is justice, because it enables spirit, what we are, to realize we never left reality, which is justice, isn't it? It's only justice there is to realize we never left. We never can leave. We can't leave reality. That's justice. Justice is to restore to us what is rightfully ours, right? So the restoration of reality to us, the awareness of reality, is justice. How could it be anything other than justice? Justice is it means we to get what is rightfully ours and to not get what is not rightfully ours. Reality is rightfully ours. So the restoration of the awareness that we never left reality, never can, that is justice. What brings this justice? Vision of oneness. Solving the continuity problem brings it. What solves the continuity problem? Vision of oneness. Vision of non-exclusion. Vision of no exception. That brings it to us. That's what brings it to us. Nothing else brings it to us. So nothing else, there's only one way to justice. There's only one way to justice. Vision of oneness is the one way to justice. That's it. So the sheep are not causing any problem at all. Right this very instant, the sheep say. This very instant. The vision of oneness doesn't exclude anything. This very instant. Oh, everything, the way it is right now, is blessed by the vision of oneness. And it's fixed blessing. God's will is fixed. God gave this blessing to the dreams. It's fixed will. It will never make an exclusion. It will never make an exception. So right this very instant, the way that everything is right now, everything is included in this vision of oneness. The terrible murderers and collaborators, the terrible polluters, the terrible discriminators, the terrible whatever it is you want to say, all the right now, this very instant, all of that is included in the vision of the blessing of the vision of oneness. Nothing is being excluded right this instant. That means your problem of continuity is solved this very instant. Your continuity problem is solved this very instant. That means justice is here for you this very moment. This very moment, perfect justice is with us. Perfect justice is with us this very instant. And it's with everyone. And will always be with everyone every instant. Always. Forever and ever. Perfect justice is with us this very instant. Right here, right now, perfect justice is with us. See, no exception. Right here, right now, no exception. Perfect justice. This very instant. And this is a realization that we have. The sheep have waiting for them. So you can say, I have perfect justice. I have perfect justice right now. I abide in perfect justice. I am abiding in perfect justice. Nothing needs to happen from this instant on. Nothing needs to happen for perfect justice to be present. It will always be present. So you can be the sheep right now. You don't have to be the goat. You don't have to pursue justice. Justice is with you this very instant. It's already here. You don't have to do anything. Nobody has to do anything. Nothing, and nothing needs to happen in the world. Absolutely nothing needs to happen in the world. Perfect justice is here this very instant, prior to anything happening. You can say, prior to anything happening, right now, prior to anything happening, perfect justice is with me. Prior to anything taking place, more present than anything, more prior to, than anything taking place, even an atom, an electron moving, prior to that, perfect justice is with me, is mine. Perfect justice is mine. Prior to anything taking place this instant, not even the motion of light, even the motion of light, prior to light going anywhere, perfect justice is with me. Light doesn't have to travel even the smallest instant in order for perfect justice to be with me right now. Right here and right here, right now, no exception, perfect justice is with me. You can use that as a mantra. I'm feeling an effect from that by using a powerful effect. Right here, right now, no exception, this perfect justice is mine, is with me. It's mine right now. Perfect justice is mine. I'm feeling very powerful. I'm feeling almost dizzy. Of course, it might be because I haven't eaten anything this morning. But there's also some power to this. The realization, I have perfect justice. Say, I have perfect justice. I have it right now. I have it without any need for anything to take place at all. I've never needed anything to take place. I never need anything to take place going forward. I don't need it at all. Right this very instant, I have perfect justice. This is an affirmation. This is an affirmation that needs to be utilized right now. Right now, I have perfect justice. I have perfect justice right now. This is the antidote. Need to take an antidote to what's happening in the world. We had the Arab Spring, of course, which was extraordinarily activist. I feel like the Shabak movement is even a step forward from that because of the rapidity of how they were able to get the laws changed retroactively without any violence at all. It's different. In the other situations, you had Mubarak and Gaddafi, and now you have, what's that guy in Syria, Assad. You have these, you know, various dictators, and the big fights, big violence, big wars, and they refuse to, you know, cave in, et cetera, et cetera. Whereas right now, you just have some university students and a flash mob, et cetera, in Shabag, and they got the leaders of the country to change some fundamental law, made it retroactive, within a matter of a week, with no shots being fired. That's a whole different speed, isn't it? You see, when I talk about the world collapsing, the will of the world collapsing into activism, that's what I'm talking about, the will of the world collapsing. They'll collapse into activism and saying, wait, we just have to get rid of the bad stuff. Let's all be activists for a while. That's what I mean. That the global contagion, what I mean is people, the global, just decide, hey, let's just be activists for a while. Let's forget about forgiveness. Let's all be goats for a while. And almost everybody will get swept up into it. Even those who are sheep right now, they'll say, wow, let's just do this for a while. This is kind of cool and hip. This is what's happening. And I better go along with it, otherwise I may be targeted. So that's what I mean, collapse of global will. the rapidity, in a week, no shots being fired. They got their demands. They have more demands. They'll probably get those met too. Is demands being met, boom, like that. Why? Because they saw what happened in the Arab Spring, and they're like shaking like crazy. Just like the corporations start capitulating. Some feminists would file a discrimination suit, and they would win or cause bad publicity. And enough of that happened where now corporations are like terrified of that, and they get all their workers together and they say, march them into sensitivity training and saying, look, this is how you must behave because we don't want any discrimination lawsuits at all. We don't. And so basically, if even any hint of a worker discriminating, as some woman says, you know what, I feel a little uncomfortable around this person, the corporation will grab that person and throw them in the wood chipper, you know. Run them through the wood chipper. Boom, like that. Even if it's a CEO, you're out, boom, immediately. They don't even wait for a judge and a jury and due process to take place. Forget about due process. We don't want any bad publicity. So what happened in the Arab Spring is that now all the other countries in the world are saying, oh my God, look what these activists could do. Look what these social media people can do. They toppled these regimes like that. They plunged the war into civil war. Just from Facebook and Twitter and stuff, they get together in a square and start chanting and singing songs. Before you know it, the whole country's in flames. So the politicians are saying, oh my God, we're going to be hung. If we don't capitulate quick, we're going to be hung. The country's going to be in flames. So they say, what do you want? Oh, we want the laws to be changed. Okay, no problem. Boom. See, that's a totally different thing. That is bringing the world on the verge of global collapse when that can happen. There's no more revolution. There's just instantaneous changing of the laws. So that's why I've been warning people for years, and people are saying, what is he talking about? You know, some people hear it, and some other people are saying, I don't know, this sounds like fear-mongering. No, it's not. I've been telling you a collapse is coming. A collapse of global will into activism is coming, and it's already here. When you have the leaders of a country just decided, with no shots being fired, decided in a week, let's just change the law, boom, like that. That's a global collapse right there. That is part of the collapse. An executive order can just be signed, boom, instant law is global collapse. There's no due process. What I'm talking about is the collapse of due process, the collapse of the safeguards, collapse of institutions safeguarding our rights. You change the law on one person, you're changing on everybody. You're changing it on everybody. Let's say you're the best person in the world, like Jesus, never did anything wrong, and he's tried. And let's say Pilate says he's innocent. Well, which Pilate did say, by the way. He says, I find no fault in this person whatsoever. I wash my hands of this. No, I'm not going to convict him. Pilate did say that. And let's say then the mob says, no. We're going to appeal that verdict. We want to be crucified. And they get their way, right? So right now in the Shaba movement, you have this terrible collaborator who did commit terrible atrocities. I'm very aware of them. In fact, he was part of the Operation Searchlight that massacred all the people in the Kali Ramana Temple. The Ramana Kali Temple and Ananda Mai Ma's ashram right there. All those people were massacred. Horrible. Okay, I'm very aware of that. The intellectuals are massacred, etc. This guy was part of doing that. So he's very much a war criminal. But if you can retroactively change the law for him, and now the prosecution can appeal any sentence, what's to stop someone who's done no harm whatsoever to anybody being accused of activists, and the court says, I find him not guilty, and the activist says, we're going to appeal and we're going to insist that they be hung because we think that they are bad stuff. It's mob rule right now. It is mob rule. What's to prevent that, you see? That is the problem, isn't it? Big problem. You can't throw out due process just because you want a more severe sentence for somebody. When you get mob rule, you get the collapse of law. And that leads to a dictatorship, a global dictatorship. To to pull you out of mob rule, then you the world says, oh my God, we need a global dictator, and then you go into global dictatorship, and then you have this total control over everyone's life, okay, which is absolutely utterly stifling in order to so-called prevent the mob rule. And then you have this draconian laws get imposed upon everybody, where everybody's a criminal. Really, because when you have a global dictatorship, everyone's a criminal under the law, but they're saved from mob rule by the dictator. See how that works? And then, of course, you are brainwashed from birth to death, cradle to grave is total brainwashing, and the notion of forgiveness and true justice, like they try to exterminate it that way. So you the total collapse is now beginning. The Shabak movement is the beginning of the total collapse. I'm telling you right now, it is. And of course, there's some people speaking out and say, "Whoa, whoa, 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 whoa! This is bad news." You know, the wiser people in the world realize, "Hey, this is trouble. This is trouble. This is trouble," and it is. The mob convicted Jesus. Pilate said, okay, look. He said, I'll tell you what, I'll make a deal. Not wanting to stir up. Pilate said, hey, basically he said, not guilty. Jesus is not guilty. I don't find him guilty of anything. Because he knew, he said, hey, this guy is really about true justice. Forget it. He's not guilty, but he realized the zealots would stir things up if he gave that verdict. He said, well, he's not guilty. I find him not guilty, but I'm going to allow you to decide, really. And so I'll give you this murderer, Barabbas, the zealot who's a murderer, or I'll give you Jesus. You can set one of those free. It's up to you. What happened? You see, what happened? What did the mob decide? What did the mob decide? Decided to crucify Jesus, what the mob decided. So don't think that just because you're a good, peaceful, loving person, that means, well, the mob won't bother you. Oh, of course the mob will bother you. Because they see you standing in the way of their goals. Because you're saying, look, I bless everyone. Let's just accept the blessing of oneness upon all. And the activists say, no, that's not the way. The way is to get rid of the bad stuff. And so you are trying to pacify our goal of being, keep our goal from being reached, because we need to be fired up and to get rid of all the bad stuff. And you're saying, no, let us just accept everything as it is right this moment, as equally blessed by the vision of Christ. And that's the way to solve the continuity problem. So it's the good guys who are going to be targeted by the activists. It's the good guys. It's Jesus who was crucified. It wasn't Barabbas. No. They said, set Barabbas free. He's a wonderful guy. He's trying to get rid of the bad stuff. He killed someone, but it was some bad guy that he killed, so that's okay. So, I hope you're getting a sense of the times that we're in. And that my warnings have not been foolish warnings at all. They've been right on the money. Right on the money. Of course, it's been a little unsteady because it's an incredibly difficult thing to do to warn the world about what's happening. A tremendous fear in doing so. Because the spirit of activism is so extreme in the world that to say these things, to warn the world, is super intimidation is brought to bear, really. So, of course, I may have soft-pedaled it in some way. It's this way or that way. Maybe the collapse is this. Maybe it's not so bad. Maybe it's this. But by and large, the message has shone through, has shined along all the time, has been shining there, and now I'm being able to be more specific. Okay, more specific, more right on the money. And it's been accurate. I mean, the general tenor of the warning has been very accurate. There is this global collapse coming. It's a collapse of will. It's a collapse of will. It's a collapse into this extreme activism, which can very easily take the format of world war. Very easily can. And now it doesn't have to necessarily. It can take on the form of a global genocide, of getting rid of all the bad stuff. It could take on the format of a actually armed conflict, or it could take on the form of global fascism, where global dictatorship. It could take on that format too. I'm not entirely sure which format it's going to take. It could take on both, but the outcome is the same. The outcome is the same, in which you are going to be locked into, as it were, the way of the goats, the way of getting rid of the bad stuff, and the other, the very notion of the other is going to be, you know, that's the bad stuff that they see. That's the ultimate bad stuff they want to get rid of. Just one second. So, remind yourself that perfect justice is always with me this very instant. Perfect justice is with me this very instant. Tell yourself that, because it's true. This vision of the blessing is within us. It's been placed within us by the Prime Creator. It's within us. We carry it with us every instant. It never is separate from us. Never. So we have it with us. Everyone has it with them. This very, each instant, and will always have it with them. Can never be separated from anyone. Perfect justice is within me right now, and I can accept it this very instant. Nothing needs to happen. See, we think, well, something needs to be gotten rid of before we can have perfect justice. Not true. The whole perfect justice is perfect because it doesn't need to get rid of anything. That's what makes it perfect. That's what makes it effective. It's perfect justice because it's effective and solves a continuity problem. That's what makes it perfect justice. Perfect justice is realizing we never left reality, and we never need to. We'll never need to. That's perfect justice. That restores what belongs to us. You see, it gives us what belongs to us, and realization that can never be taken away from us. You see, in this world where everything can be taken away from everything, how can we find justice in that? How can we find justice? That's impossible. We keep thinking we need to kill those who can take stuff away from us. We just get rid of all that. Now everything is impermanent. Total impermanence here in the world. Total injustice for us. Total injustice. Existence is totally unjust to us. Always will be. All of it is totally unjust. And again, the remedy is to see a dream of non-exclusion, where everything is blessed, equally blessed. So, this information is not a secret. It's not a secret at all. I'm sharing it with you right now. I'm sharing it with everybody in the world. And whoever wants to watch can watch. It's no secret. There's no price. I'm not putting any price on it. I'm not asking for donations for these videos, for this. It's free. It's free. I mean, you do need an internet connection, but you can watch on your friends if you want. But there's no charge for this. There's no charge for this justice, this perfect justice. There's no charge for it. There's no cost at all. No cost to you whatsoever. It's with you right this moment, this instant, prior to anything changing. It's with you already. There's no price at all. No price. God is not charging some price. God is just saying, hey, you need to realize that you never left reality. Why is that a cost to God? Who is that a costly to? No one. Reality isn't costly to itself. This blessing didn't cost God anything. God just a reminder. What does a reminder cost God or cost reality? Nothing. Nothing at all. So that this perfect justice is free. It's totally free. It doesn't cost anything. And this perfect justice is with each one of us every instant. Everyone, without exception, has this blessing with them every instant, and always will, with no cost, and totally free, never will have a cost to it, because we never left reality. All of reality belongs to us, always will. Where's there cost in that? There's no cost at all. Reality is free to all of reality is free unto itself, it's not costly unto itself. So this blessing is free. It's absolutely free. And each one of us has it within us. It's not like we're getting it from someone else outside of us. So there's a cost. Of course, if you go to see a guru or someone, there's a cost to transportation and food to get there and all that stuff. But no, they're not giving it to you. It's within you. It's a choice. It's already within you. You simply have to accept it. And there's no cost to that whatsoever. And again, it's prior to anything changing within you. Anything changing whatsoever, it's prior to that. It's right here, this instant. So you don't even need to change anything. You don't need to do anything for to accept it. Don't need to do anything at all. So how costly can that be? How costly is this very instant? What cost can this very instant prior to anything changing or happening whatsoever? How can that have a cost? How can that have, that must be free, right? Must be free. So this information is being shared, freely shared. Creative Commons, public domain. I'm not putting any price on it in the future either. These videos are public domain. They don't give you that option on Creative. They say you can put it on Creative Commons, but it's really public domain. Now, in some of the videos, I use some music, etc. That somebody else says, well, that's Creative Commons, and you need to have attribution and share alike, non-commercial attribution, share alike. In other words, don't make money off of it. You have to share it with others on the same license and give attribution. But for these ones that have nothing with it, just me talking, it's public domain. No, it's in the public domain. Meaning nobody can claim authorship of it and make money off of it. It's public domain. It's free for everybody. Now, if somebody wants to use it in some way, I mean, they can. Anyone can use it any way they want to. But it's free to everybody. So that's mirroring. The vision of Christ is free to everybody. Vision of oneness, vision of non-exclusion, non-exception, is already given to us. Freely given to us. No cost ever to us. No cost ever to anyone. It's free to everyone. Always will be. All these people running around trying to get money, so they can buy what they really want. What they really want, true justice, is already with them. They already have it. And it's free. So why are they wasting their time trying to gain control of all of the world so they can have enough money to purchase something perfect? What do they want? They want to purchase justice. But they don't understand what justice is. Justice is perfect. Justice is already with us. We already have it. It's free. It's with us right now. No charge at all. Totally free. And it's totally free to everyone. So we think, oh, well, it's free for me, but it's not free to others. No, it's free to everybody. It's free to everyone. Everyone. So everyone has perfect justice right now. Everyone has perfect justice right now. So what are we waiting for, you see? What are we waiting for to be happy? Why are we waiting for anything? Everyone has perfect justice right now. Everyone. All the activists, they have perfect justice with them right now too. They're just ignoring it. Which is their right to do if they want to. But they still have it. They still have it. So we don't need to feel any guilt. On their accord, they already have perfect justice. So what do we need to feel guilty for? We need to do something for them? No, nothing needs to be done. They already have it. If someone has a glass of water and they're screaming, I'm thirsty, I'm thirsty, I'm thirsty, you're causing me to be thirsty. No, nobody's causing anyone to be thirsty. Nobody's bringing injustice upon anyone. Everyone already has perfect justice. Because they have this equal blessing, equal vision, overlay, vision of Christ, vision of oneness. They already have that, and that solves the continuity problem. And solving the continuity problem brings awareness that no one ever left reality, which restores everything to them. They never realize they never lost it, which is perfect justice. So everyone has perfect justice already. Everyone. So no guilt. Where's the guilt? Who can be treated unjustly? Impossible. Because that means that perfect justice is not with someone. It is with everybody. So how can anyone lose it? They cannot. How can they throw it away? They cannot. God placed it there. God's will is fixed will. It remains with each one. Nobody can throw it away. So where's the guilt? Where's the crime? Where's the injustice? It's nowhere. There is no injustice. There's only our desire for an injustice, but there is no real injustice at all. Those who see injustice is because they desire to be prime creator. They want to be prime creator. So they believe that the God's will is not fixed. You see, so that there can be injustice. There is no perfect justice. It's a matter to be determined, yet to be determined. And they're the ones, of course, who are trying to determine it. But all that is just a hypothetical scenario. No reality to whatsoever. No such thing as real guilt. No such thing. Everybody has perfect justice. Has had perfect justice every instant. Never a time when they didn't have perfect justice. And never will be a time. Never will be a time when everyone doesn't have perfect justice with them each instant prior to anything happening. That is a fact. That is a fact. So, build your foundation of your destiny on facts. On facts, okay? Yeah, absolutely. Build it on facts. Don't build it on denial of facts. What kind of destiny is that? Denial of facts? That's bound to be a terrible, terrible, miserable suffering in some imaginary darkness. So the good news is that it's all on, you know. It is really on now. This is great news. Because now we can really say, hey, let's get real. Time to get real. And we will do so each and every day. So, to keep this type of intensity that I have in this video, theoretically I could keep it all day, but the surroundings that I have now, I cannot act this way and talk this way. Not yet, but hopefully sometime soon I'll be able to. Because this feels great. It feels great to be this way, to be adamant and share this information, share truth with the world, share truth with everyone, share truth. Everybody's already saved. Everybody's already has perfect justice. We're saved because of perfect justice. We already have the blessing of oneness, which is perfect justice. It leads to the realization, the solving of the continuity problem. We already have that. Everything's already saved, totally. Always has been. Always will be. There's no injustice. There's no guilt. There's no injustice. Never. Never. It's only our desire for it. But that's also totally unnecessary. Totally unnecessary. Reality can't be changed in any way. We don't need any contingency plan. We don't need any hypothetical of what if reality were annihilated. We don't need any of it. No necessity to whatsoever. So, zero necessity means we're already saved from it. It cannot be, nothing can be gripping us. We cannot be gripped by anything. We cannot be gripped by injustice. Cannot. We can try and grip it, but we cannot be gripped by it. It's weird, the ones who are desperately trying to find it and grip it, and we can't find it. It's not gripping us. We're not being gripped by anything. Only by our desire to be gripped by something. See? But there is nothing there that is gripping us. It's only our own desire. That's all. And we can easily set that down as we accept the solution to the continuity problem. Because the only reason we don't set the desire down to be gripped by something, to be gripped by injustice, is because we don't realize that there's a solution to the continuity problem. That is the only reason. That's the only reason. The only problem we have is a continuity problem. That is it. That is it. Desire is not really a problem because it's the fear of setting it down that's the problem. See, that is the only problem. That's the real issue. Because of course, as long as we don't set it down, of course we're going to feel as we're being gripped by injustice. Of course, of course. So the problem really is setting it down. And why don't we set it down? Fear of continuity. Abrupt break in continuity. That is why. Once we see that there's a solution to this continuity problem, setting desire down. Oh, please, let me set it down. My gosh, I don't want that. I never wanted it. That's horrible. Horrible. We've never really wanted it. good grief, it's plunged us into this nightmare of disaster. We don't want desire. We want to set it down. But the continuity issue prevents that. See, we hesitate. That's it. So all our efforts has to be towards recognizing the continuity problem has been solved. It's always been solved. And that this blessing of oneness with no exception, no exclusion, is the solution of the continuity problem. And then we'll say, set desire down. And we're not being gripped by anything. And that will, then we'll realize, we don't need hypotheticals at all. We can recognize that we're never left reality. So there is a resolution to what this, all this trouble and all this problems we think we have. There is a resolution to it. Absolutely is. The teachers who know about this have taught us correctly. I've been taught by a couple of them. They taught correctly. They base their teaching on facts. The Holy Spirit bases his teaching on facts. And the blessing of the Prime Creator upon dreams is based on fact, which is that God's will is a fixed will. It's not variable. It can't be changed. Reality can't be changed, which is a great thing. That means all of reality still belongs to us. All the infinite riches still belong to us. They always will. That's a great thing. And we can never be gripped by something else. We can never be gripped by something else. And we can never grip anything else, really. And this desire, we can set desire down and experience perfect justice. Everybody. Everybody has perfect justice with them this very instant and every instant. So this is the antidote. This is the antidote to getting swept up in that terrible feeling of injustice and retribution and vengeance and activism and attack and fear and threat and war and violence and death, despair and dictatorship and brainwashing. All this stuff is the antidote. It is the antidote. It is the escape from that. And the way the world's going right now, we very well may need relocation. We'll see. We'll see. Will there be some miraculous turnaround? I hope so. But pray for the best. Prepare for the worst and pray for the best. Pray for the best, prepare for the worst kind of thing. I'm certainly gearing myself up to possible relocation. And also at the same time, doing everything I can to turn it around in the world. Sharing this information is everything I can do, really. That is all that can be done. See, that's the thing. That's the thing. It's not like you can do something more. You have to share the truth. And the truth will set you free. And if people don't want to accept it, that's all you can do. You cannot force anyone to accept the truth. You cannot force anyone to set down desire to if they want to continue to try to be Prime Creator, you cannot force them to stop that. So it's not like there's going to be some totally miraculous event that everybody just, truth is already being shared. And if the world decides to ignore it, that's what they'll do. They'll ignore it. They'll go on the path of activism. That's what will happen. It's not like I can do a whole lot more, really. I mean, what more could Jesus do? What more could Ananda Mahima do? What more could they have done? They did everything perfect, flawlessly. It's not like there's something they didn't do, something that they could have done which they didn't do. No, not at all. Not at all. They already did it perfect, and the world ignored them. I mean, look at Shabbat. Everyone's Shabbat completely ignoring the fact that of all the years that she lived there and her presence was there, it's completely ignoring it. So, if spirit decides to ignore what it is, it's free to do that. Can't force it not to. So that is why I'm saying relocation seems to be a likelihood, because it seems as though the world is very much ignoring the sharing of truth, both those in the past and those who are following in the footsteps on the shoulders of those and doing their best to share it in the present time, very much being ignored. And the only evaluation that I'm seeing taking place is pretty much evaluation of how can we use this person for the purpose of activism. Now, for instance, Muji. Muji, I feel, is a very good teacher, coming from a very good place, a very good heart. And he seems to have a vision of oneness. It seems that way. Now, I'm not sure, but it seems that way. There's a lot of positives I see. But what I also see is it seems like there's a lot of those people around him kind of evaluating him to see, how can I use this guy for the purpose of activism? How can I use him as a figurehead for activism, for getting rid of the bad stuff? So, and I see that in a lot of teachers in the world now, is that what they're sharing is not really being received. I think Muji's trying to share this, and he gets frustrated because he says, gosh, you guys are really not receiving what I'm sharing with you. And there's a frustration. And Anandamayi said, hey, in my whole life I've shared all this with you, and very few have been receptive to it. And Muji's, same thing with Muji, he's sharing this, and it's really not being received very well. He's being evaluated as seeing how valuable can he be to this activist movement that we need, the world wants to say, come, let's make him the chief guru of the world because he's empowering activism. They're hoping for that, and Muji's saying, no, I'm not interested in that. So, you know, if Muji cannot really reach people, and he has a very endearing way of doing it, really, a lot of heart, a lot of love, a lot of heart, very endearing way. If he can't be doing it this time, who can? You know, who can? I have a totally different style. Totally different style. But his style is this very kind of motherly style. He's like a mother, sort of. It's a motherly style. And if he can't reach it, who can? You know, that's like, wow. So I don't have a lot of hope that there's some style that can reach the world at this time. Some style. Does my style working at this point? No. I don't even have the vision of oneness yet. But I do have a style. Is that style just like everybody going, wow, what a great style? No. Muji's style is not really doing it. Anybody's style doing it right now? I can't find anyone. I cannot find anyone whose style is really, same with Eckhart Tolle. His style, people are evaluating him. Hey, maybe we can use this guy to be a figurehead for this global activism. That's what I'm seeing. Same with A Course in Miracles. Are the people teaching that, is their style working? No. I mean, Oprah says, hey, maybe I can use A Course in Miracles to be the curriculum for global activism here or something. Or various people who where is the style that's working? I can't find it. I cannot find it, which is kind of frightening. Cannot find it. I don't find anyone in the world right now with a style that is getting through. What I see is everyone who tries to bring the truth into the world, they're surrounded by activists who are evaluating how valuable they can be to their plan of activism. That's what I see taking place. And I don't really want to be surrounded by that. It's a waste of time. So I stay kind of at a distance from it. And what I see, that's why I say I believe that relocation will be necessary, because I don't see any style that's going to work to turn it around. I really don't. And everything that's utilized can easily be translated into activism. Since let's say you have a big rally, a peace rally, and all these singers and musicians and songs, and everybody there, they start picking up, hey, let's sing songs, let's hold hands, let's get together. Easily that goes into activism. Easily. Become peace activists. Peace activists. Which means they're saying something needs to change before I can experience justice within me. And let's all sing songs. Let's all get together. Let's empower. Get this feeling of emotionalism and empowerment and ability to overcome any obstacles. Get rid of the bad stuff. Get justice. Let's all get fired up for social justice. Let's all light the candles. Let's all sing the songs. Let's all hold hands. Let's all tweet. Let's all share on Facebook. Let's all take videos. Let's all get social justice. Let's get rid of the bad stuff. Easily anything gets translated into that. And of course, I don't want anything to do with any of that. I've never been part of any social movement of any kind, protest movements. I've never done anything like that. Never. All during the 60s, I never attended any protest movements, anything. Because I always said, no, that's not it. I always kept my distance from all social activism, all activism of any kind. I've never been part of it. Never been part of it. And I've tried to lead people out of that, as a matter of fact. And that's caused me a lot of trouble because I had to get close enough to it to try to reach in and help people. And then that caused me a lot of fear and trepidation and stress. And continues to. And even on these tapings, I try to say, yeah, everything's terrible, but here's the way to get out of that. But it still causes a lot of stress. So relocation may very well be in the cards. It very well may be in the cards because I don't see things turning around in the world. It is conceivable. Well, actually, what we think as a bulwark, as a firewall against the activism, is this compromise movement of the law. Let's just try and compromise between the sheep and the goats, as if those are the two warring parties. They're not. It's activists warring with activists that are the warring parties, really. And the law is really an attempt to keep them away from each other's throats. Like, for instance, in Libya, Gaddafi, such a terrible dictator and blah, blah, blah. But really, I mean, what his purpose was to keep all these warring factions from tearing each other's heads off. Same thing in Syria, same thing in Egypt, all this stuff. Dictators are there. The strongmen are there. The dictators is to prevent this factionalism of activism in their where they are from destroying one another. So they rule with an iron fist, you know, to keep the activists down in prison. That's what their purpose is. And sure, they throw people in prison. They throw the chief activists in prison, so they keep activism on a low simmer. And you get rid of the dictator, what happens? The whole country's up in flames, destroyed. And then they go, oh no, we need a new dictator. And then a new dictatorship arises, just like that. So what the problem is the so-called compromisers are there to prevent the activists from tearing each other to pieces. But when you get activists get so inflamed, they just said, hey, forget it. We don't want this law anymore. Let's just have no law. Let's just all fight it out. And we know what's right. We know what's true. We don't need any laws to tell us what's true. So we don't forget about laws. Let us do our thing, and then peace will prevail and happiness will prevail. And so you get the collapse of law in such a situation. So that is what we're headed to. And the only question is, will the rule of law prevail? And will we kind of keep this simmering truce among activism, sort of simmering truce? Will we be able to keep that? I don't know. Maybe not. Maybe not. We're seeing signs of it collapsing. A lot of signs, all these executive orders and stuff, that's a sign of it collapsing. Basically, activists saying, hey, we don't want due process. We don't need due process. We know what's right. What do we need Congress for? What do we need the Bill of Rights for? What do we need the Constitution for? That's just getting in our way. We already know what's right. We know what's right better than all that stuff. So forget it. Just let's sign executive orders and let's just go right around it and let's get marching to truth, righteousness. Justice. We know what justice is, the activists say. We know it perfectly well. Let's get marching on to it and let's get it done now. So the way things are going, I would say that there's the collapse of law is on its way. It's already collapsing very badly. So without the rule of law, then there's no way to turn it around. Even within the rule of law, it's very tough to turn around, and yet some institutions can function within that to some extent. But as far as a quick turnaround right now, I don't see any style that could do it. You know, I mean, how could you have anyone better than Jesus or Anandamayi Mock? Their styles were so incredibly great. Anandamayi Mock's style, unsurpassed style, spiritual style. I mean, everyone that met her loved her, just loved her style. Loved it. Just said, my gosh, what a great style. And so you can't get a better style than that. And if that didn't work at all, what's going to work? It's, you know, perfect truth, perfect style, perfect everything, flawless everything, and that didn't turn anything around at all. So I would hazard to say relocation, it will happen. I would hazard to say that. But again, we'll see what happens. But why not prepare for it? At least you prepare for it by realizing that no guilt, everyone has perfect justice with them already. They're only seeking injustice. So they're bringing problems upon themselves. And why should you feel, any of us feel guilty about that? There's no reason to feel guilt. They're doing it because they want to be prime creator. They want to be greater than God. They want to destroy reality. So then put themselves on a throne of a new reality. So they're bringing suffering upon themselves, really. Nobody's causing anyone else to suffer. Everyone brings suffering upon themselves. Everyone, because everyone has freedom of choice. They don't have to choose to be prime creator. That didn't get imposed from somewhere. God didn't impose upon us that we have to unseat the prime creator and become prime creator. No, each aspect of spirit chose that for themselves. So they have this desire. This desire wants to be gripped by injustice. So, of course, this desire will believe it's being gripped by injustice, but that doesn't make us guilty of it. No one's guilty of anything. Each one of us is bringing suffering upon ourselves. So there's no injustice. There's no guilt. There's no injustice. There's no guilt. There's no reason why we can't relocate with a clear conscience, with no guilt, and understanding that everyone has perfect justice, and the willingness, of course, to help out when it's possible. With collapse of law, ruled by activists, and then return to some severe dictatorship, of course, that's not going to afford the right opportunity to help out. So maybe some other time, some other place, we'll see. Let the Holy Spirit decide those things, whatever it is, either relocation or non-relocation is fine with me. Either way is fine. But it may come down to relocation, so I have to at least say, okay, that's very possible, and prepare for it. Rehearse for it, prepare for it, and not be afraid of it. Because you don't help the activists at all by being playing the victim for them. You don't help them the slightest bit. You just empower their insanity, empower their desire. Say, yeah, we got rid of part of the bad stuff. Let's get rid of some more. This is working. If you want to cool it all down, which we do, relocate. That'll cool it down. It really will cool it down. Because they'll say, oh my gosh, potentially some of the very worst guys possible, worst stuff possible, escaped. They're gone. We can't get them. They'll say, oh my gosh, this whole thing is not hardly worth it then. And they'll say, we lost again. And they'll kind of go in kind of sort of a depression, which is a good thing, actually. Depression is a cool down, actually. It really is. And then they'll start thinking, then the Holy Spirit can start suggesting to them, hey, maybe there's a way to get out of this depression. It's a good thing. It's a good thing. I mean, the quicker they go into cool down mode, the better. I mean, depression, severe depression, is actually a cool down mode where you're not able to act out your activism and destroy all the bad stuff. So you feel very depressed. And then the Holy Spirit can say, hey, you know, there is an answer to your depression. And if you just are willing to pay attention, I'll share with you what it is. And then that can happen. It will happen. So really, the best thing anyone can do right now is to relocate. The very most compassionate thing anyone can do is to relocate. I'm telling you this as a fact. This is the most compassionate. Now, activists won't see it that way. But it is, you see. They're not in their right mind right now. Because it will lead to eventual depression, a feeling of depression, which is a cool down. It will lead to a cool down. They say, what's the use? The real bad stuff has already escaped. We can't get it. What's the use? And they'll cool down. Say, throw down their weapons and say, what's the use? And then they'll get real depressed. And they'll sit there. They'll sit there in their caves, you know, just, I'm depressed. I don't want to do anything. I don't feel like doing anything. It's useless. My life is useless. I don't feel like doing anything. It's terrible. I hate this life. It's terrible. They get really depressed like this and, hey, should we do something? Nah, forget it. I don't want to do anything. This world sucks. Everything sucks. Everything's terrible. I don't want to do anything. Then they get despaired. Then they feel this mental chaos, like everything is just chaos. I don't know. Then the Holy Spirit says, hey, there's a way out of this. I'll share it with you. Huh? Why? What? Really? Okay, well, what do you have to share? And then the sharing starts happening, and the spiritual path starts happening. Path to accepting perfect justice, realizing it's already with us, happens, and before you know it, they're just as free as we are. That abso. How do you help that out? By relocating. by making them realize that, hey, we did escape. It's useless. It's useless. They'd never be able to hunt down all the bad stuff, as it were. It's useless. That is actually what helps. Counterintuitive seems to know it's not counterintuitive. It's not counterfacts. It's not counterfacts at all. So if you want to do the most loving, compassionate action possible, relocate from this planet. Relocate. That is the ultimate. That is the ultimate. And accept perfect justice for yourself. Those two things. Accept perfect justice for yourself and relocate. And that will give an enormous boost to everyone on the planet. An enormous boost. Because they will have no choice at some point. Then they'll cool down quicker. They'll go into this depressed mode quicker, and then they'll hit bottom quicker. And once you hit bottom, then the Holy Spirit, they'll be receptive to what the Holy Spirit shares with them about the way to a true way of salvation. That perfect justice is with them right now. The continuity problem is the only problem anyone has. And they'll be receptive to that, and they'll quickly pick up on this. And before you know it, boom, they'll accept it. Perfect justice for themselves. The continuity problem will be solved, and they'll realize, we don't need any hypotheticals, and they'll awaken in reality and say, all of reality is mine forever. Very quickly. All right, so keep that in mind. The relocation's on the front burner. It still is on the front burner. And perfect justice right here, right now. Perfect justice right here, right now. No exception. Boom. Perfect justice right here, right now. No exception. Those two things. Perfect justice right here, right now. No exception. It's mine. Right now. Right here, right now. Perfect justice is mine. Right here, right now. No exception. And compassionate action. Relocation. Relocation. The right thing to do. I'll come up with some mantra for that. Relocate right now. Relocation right now. Right thing right now. Relocation right action right now. Relocation right action right now. Relocation, right action, right now. Try those things. Those affirmations will help you align. Relocation, right action, right now. Relocation, right action, right now. All right. Moving along fast, because everything in this boom is happening very fast. So we're moving along. We're staying one step ahead of it right now. All right. Relocation, right action, right now. Perfect justice, my perfect justice right here, right now, no exception. My perfect justice right here, right now. My perfect justice is right here, right now, no exception. Relocate, right action, right now. Very great. That's it for this one.